الحمد لله الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فقد قال عز وجل في كتابه العزيز بعد أن أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم نعمتان مغبون فيهما كثير من الناس الصحة والفراغ أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام صدق الله مولانا العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم ونحن على ذلك لمن الشاهدين والشاكرين والحمد لله رب العالمين. My dear friends, respected elders, a very important question that we need to ask ourselves as we knock on the doors of Ramadan. A very important question that we need to ask ourselves and to the ones around us is that are we prepared for this month of Ramadan? Are you and I ready? Are we prepared for this month of Ramadan? And the preparation that I am talking and I'm speaking of is not the preparation of our groceries. I need to take my wife to the grocery store. I need to buy this and I need to buy that. Or the preparation of Ramadan, I'm not speaking of how much weight I'm going to lose this month of Ramadan. I'm going to drop 15 pounds, 20 pounds. That's not the preparation I'm speaking of. We need to ask ourselves, just like how you see normally, that when there is a sale, and you hear about that sale, or there was something that you've been eyeing for such a long time, you wanted to buy that thing for your house, someone who does not have any furniture inside his house, day in and day out he's thinking, where is the best deal I can find? Always looking around, searching, asking his friends, hey, show me a website or show me a place where I could go ahead and, you know, find something that is very cheap. Or find something that is very good, but that's on sale. It'll save me some money. Always looking in. Always searching for something better. Now the same aspect, the same rule, if we apply to it, if we apply in our dini aspect, in our dini life, that how we're searching for improvements every single day, day in and day out, we're searching for improvements in our worldly life. Looking for things that'll benefit us. Looking for deals that'll benefit us. Wallahi, my respected brothers and elders, the month of Ramadan is a deal from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The month of Ramadan is a sale from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The month of Ramadan, Allah ta'ala has opened up His doors. Now you and I need to ask ourselves, you and I need to ask that, hey, what do I want to accomplish? What do I want to get? You have a list. Normally, when you're searching for something, when you want to buy something, you're looking for a car. You need, oh, I need this type of a car. It should have this, it should have that. My house that I'm looking for, it should have this. It should have a nice big kitchen. It should have a nice big living room, dining room. It should have this and it should have that. Space to accommodate my family, my parents, everyone. You have these lists. You're checking them as you go along. Now the month of Ramadan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is teaching us and He wants us to see that what are you and I accomplishing? What am I gaining? What do I want from this month of Ramadan? The previous months that have passed in my life, the previous Ramadans that I have passed in my life, how many things have I accomplished in those Ramadans? What have I gained in those Ramadans? Or is it that every single Ramadan that has passed in my life is the same, where I'm not getting anywhere? I'm not getting anywhere. The Ramadan that passed last year is going to be the same that it'll be this year. I don't know if I'm going to be able to accomplish the recitation of the entire Quran or not. Or I don't know how spiritual I will get, or how my ta'alluq, my connection with get with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We don't know. And we're just wandering around. We're just roaming around. We don't know what to accomplish and what to gain from this month of Ramadan. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us this month here for you and I to check now, to see that, okay, am I missing Quran in my life? That means what? The month of Ramadan, I have to connect myself with the Quran. Am I missing Salah in my life? Okay, it's time to get back into the masjid for fara'il. Am I missing my connection with my parents? How am I dealing with people? Am I missing that? Okay, the month of Ramadan is a very good starting point for me. To start dealing, to start whatever I need to bring that thing into my life. It's a sale from Allah Ta'ala. Allah Ta'ala has every single night in this month of Ramadan, Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala has covered it with mercy, with rahmah. And Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala has given so much. The hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was once sitting with his companions, Sahaba. So the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam spoke of four people from the time of Bani Israel. Four individuals from the time of Bani Israel who fought in the path of Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala for 80 years. How many years? 80 years. They fought in the cause of Allah Ta'ala, in the path of Allah. So the Sahaba, they were surprised. The companions of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, they're surprised. Ya Nabiullah, we don't even get to live that long. Do we get to live that long? 60, 70 max. If you're very lucky, 80. Ya Nabiullah, we don't even get to live that long. And these people, they're fighting in the cause of Allah Ta'ala for that many years, 80 years. That such a long lifespan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of Nuh alayhi salam in the Quran. And Nuh alayhi salam, Allah ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا نُوحًا إِلَىٰ قَوْمِهِ فَلَبِثَ فِيهِمْ أَلْفَ سَنَةٍ إِلَّا خَمْسِينَ عَامًا. When Nuh alayhi salam was in this world for not 100 years, he was in this world for 950 years. But then again, of course, this dunya doesn't really matter. You still have to leave this world, no matter how long you live here for. Right? Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, and he told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, يَا نَبِيَ اللَّهِ عِشْ مَا شِئْتَ فَإِنَّكَ مَيِّتَ. Ya Nabi Allah, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam, live for how much longer you want. Live for how much ever long you want. You want to live for 1,000 years, 2,000 years. But فَإِنَّكَ مَيِّتَ, there will come a time when you have to taste the bitterness of death. وَحْبَبْ مَنْ شِئْتَ فَإِنَّكَ مُفَارِقُهُ. Love whomever you want, there will come a time where you have to be separated from that individual, from that person. So you can live for however long. Anyhow, so the Sahaba have the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to say, Ya Nabi Allah, 80 years, Ya Nabi Allah, how is this possible? We don't even get to live for that long. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this is just for you and I. Just for you and I, the ummah, the nation of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us one night. One night in the month of Ramadan. One night in the month of Ramadan, which is equivalent to 1,000 months. One night in the month of Ramadan is equivalent to so many, 1,000 months. And it was a golden rule. There's a hadith where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he revealed down the ayah to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مَنْ جَاءَ بِالْحَسَنَةِ فَلَهُ عَشْرُ أَمْثَالِهَا. And this is a rule, of course, that has been there from the time of Adam alayhi salam till the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That you do one deed, you do one good deed, Allah ta'ala will multiply it by 10. It's not just for us, it was for the nations before as well. That you do one good deed and Allah ta'ala will multiply it by 10. So when this ayah was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ya Rabbi zid ummati. Ya Allah, increase for my ummah. Ya Allah, increase for my ummah. Yes, I know one multiplied by 10. That's there. But Ya Allah, increase for my ummah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed down the ayah upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مثل الذين ينفقون أموالهم في سبيل الله. The ones who spend in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah ta'ala will multiply it by many folds. Allah yudha'ifu kathir, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will multiply it by many folds. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he still insisted, Ya Allah, zid ummati. Ya Rabbi, zid ummati. Ya Allah, increase for my ummah, increase for my nation. Where they do one good deed and it is so easy for them to do, and that Allah ta'ala will multiply it by so much for them. So again, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's telling Allah, Ya Allah, Ya Rabbi, zid ummati. Increase for my ummah, Ya Allah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals in the ayah to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ أَمْوَالَهُمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ كَمَثَلِ حَبَّةٍ أَنْبَتَتْ سَبْعَ سَنَابِلْ فِي كُلِّ سُنْبُلَةٍ مِئَةُ حَبَّةٍ. That you do one good deed, Allah ta'ala will multiply it by 700. Allah ta'ala will multiply it by 700. You do one good deed, Allah ta'ala will multiply it by 700. Is there anything like that in this world? Any business like that? You give a dollar, you get 700 back. No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's dealing in this manner. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he still insists. And he said, Ya Rabbi zid ummati. Ya Rabbi zid ummati. Ya Allah, increase for my ummah. Subhanallah. What a Nabi, what a Prophet. Looking after you and I. Made it so easy for you and I to do good deeds. You do one. Imagine, he's still asking Allah, Ya Allah, Ya Rabbi zid ummati. Rabbi zid ummati. Increase for my ummah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then revealed in the ayah to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّمَا يُوَفَّ الصَّابِرُونَ أَجْرَهُمْ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. That now, Ya Nabi Allah, no more accountability. No more counting. It's a blind check. Write whatever you want to write. Ask Allah ta'ala for whatever you want to ask. يُوَفَّ الصَّابِرُونَ أَجْرَهُمْ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. That as long as you have sabr and you have patience, You hope for reward in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you hope for reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you have sabr. Allah ta'ala says, بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ, without any accounts. You can have whatever you want. I'll give you whatever you want. Name it, I'll give it to you. So this is the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's dealing with the ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now we need to ask ourselves, that what are we trying to accomplish? What are we trying to gain from this month of Ramadan? This month of Ramadan, 2 days away, a day or 2 days away. What is there on my list that I want to accomplish? What is it on my list that I want to gain in this month of Ramadan? Keep on questioning yourself. Ask your family. Ask your parents. Ask your sisters. Ask your brothers. Ask your wife. Ask your children. The month of Ramadan is right there. What is your goal? Tell me your goal. We all have goals in life. From the morning till the night, you tell your kids, hey, my son, you need to become a doctor so you can earn money, inshallah. Well, my son, you need to do this so you can earn a good living. My son, you need to look at this business. Try earning this. Try doing this. You might earn some money. Try doing this. You might earn some more. We are telling our kids about dunya, every single day about dunya. Now is the time to ask your kids, oh my son, oh my daughter, the month of Ramadan is right here. What are you trying to accomplish? What are you trying to gain? This is my goal. My goal is that inshallah I'm going to pray salah in the masjid every single day. My goal is that I'm going to complete a whole entire Quran in the month of Ramadan. My goal is this, my goal is that. What is your goal? What is your goal? It is very sad that throughout the whole day, we speak to our kids, we speak to our family members about everything about this world, everything that is concerned and that is related to this world. But we like to speak to them about the Akhirah. We like to speak to them about this, the Akhirah. And what is their goal? What are they'll accomplish from this world? What are they going to accomplish from their Akhirah? So we need to ask the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And of course, the 15th of Sha'aban just passed, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentioned that the month of Ramadan, and on that night, of course, as well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives everyone. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he forgives everyone, Allah ta'ala, of course, he excluded there a certain number of people. But in that riwayah that I'm speaking of, the narration, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Allah ta'ala does not forgive two types of people. Two types of individuals Allah ta'ala does not forgive. Number one is a mushrik, a person who does not believe in Allah ta'ala, which means the lack of iman. He does not have iman. And the second person is a mushahid, and we'll get into that inshallah. Now these two things, I want to elaborate a little more, is because these two things, if we really hold on to them, if we really hold on firm to them, these are two things that will benefit us in the month of Ramadan inshallah. So the first person the Prophet ﷺ says is a mushrik. Is a person who associates partners with Allah Ta'ala, who does not believe in Allah Ta'ala. Which means you jeopardize your iman. You do not have full complete iman in Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. Now our iman that Allah Ta'ala has given us, the iman that we do have, we say La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. We do have iman. Now we need to check that how strong is our iman in Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. How strong is my tawakkul in Allah Ta'ala? How strong is my belief in Allah Ta'ala? How strong is my yaqeen in Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala? That am I always worried about this dunya? Am I always worried about this dunya? Or am I at the same time worried about the Khaliq who has created me? Who is giving me everything? Who is sustaining me? Who is feeding me? So this is the first thing. Our iman. How strong is our iman? The companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, at every single given moment in their life, they would always be worried about their iman. Always be worried about their iman. Wallahi, we say we do claim that we have iman. We do claim that we say the kalima. But do we know we're going to die with it? Do we know that we'll die with it? Am I 100% sure that before I die, I would die in the state of being a Muslim? Wallahi, there are thousands of youth out there that are leaving the fold of Islam, that are leaving iman. For what? For what? You die without iman, what do you have? Even if you had everything in this world, but imagine the kuffar waking on the day of Qiyamah. And they know that they'll be in Jahannam. They know that they'll be punished in that hellfire. They'll be tortured in that hellfire. But you know what will make it worse? Is the fact that knowing I'm not going to be coming out of this pain ever again. There is a suffering, there is a pain. When you go through pain, you hope to get better, to feel better. But when there is such a pain which you know that it'll stick with you for the rest of your life, that is very hard to bear. So people who are dying without iman, imagine these people jeopardizing their iman, putting their iman into trial and test. What are they going through? Where are they ending up? And as I said, the Sahaba of the Prophet ﷺ, they were very cautious. They were very cautious. At the time of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, there was an individual with the name of Bal'am bin Ba'ura. Now Bal'am, he was considered one of the mustajab al-da'wah. Mustajab al-da'wah. What does mustajab al-da'wah mean? It means that every time you supplicate to Allah, every time you make dua to Allah, Allah Ta'ala, He is there to listen to you. Allah Ta'ala will answer your call. So you raise your hands, the minute you raise your hands and the minute you supplicate to Allah, Allah Ta'ala is there listening to you. He'll answer your call. This is mustajab al-da'wah. Now, Bal'am bin Ba'ura, under the ayah, وَاتْلُ عَلَيْهِمْ نَبَأَ الَّذِي آتَيْنَاهُ آيَاتِنَا فَانْسَلَخَ مِنْهَا فَأَتْبَعَهُ الشَّيْطَانُ فَكَانَ مِنَ الْغَاوِينَ. Allahu Ta'ala, He's speaking of this person, speaking of this individual. That recite to them the ayat, the signs of that person who was given from Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala a sign. And that was what? He was so close to Allah. His connection with Allah Ta'ala was so close. Where the people came to Bal'am. The people of Bani Israel, they came. And they said, you know what? We want to go ahead and fight with Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, and we hope that we take down Musa and his army. So you being mustajab al-da'wah, we know that every time you supplicate to your Rabb, to your God, He listens to you, He answers your call. So can you please make dua against Musa? Can you please make dua against Musa, a Nabi of Allah, a Prophet of Allah? Again, holding on to your iman, holding on to your faith. Very important. So they're telling Bal'am that make dua against Musa. So Bal'am says, man, are you crazy? You want me to make dua against Musa? He's a prophet of Allah. He's Kalimullah. He can speak to Allah. What do you mean make dua against Musa? So these people, they go back. Like, oh, you know what? We don't really have any hope now. They go back. When they go back, one of them says to them, that you know what? Gather so much wealth, all the treasures that you have, gold, silver, whatever you have, gather it all. Few days pass by, they go back to Bal'am. Now when they go to Bal'am, they present all of that gold. They present all of that wealth. And they say, oh Bal'am, you know, do we have an offer now? Make dua against Musa. Supplicate against Musa. So, now of course he comes under the pressure. And he goes ahead and he makes dua against Musa, alayhi salatu wasalam. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's speaking of this individual in this ayah. Now he knows that if I supplicate and if I make dua against Musa, what would happen? I would no longer have my dunya and I would no longer have my akhirah. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the narration it comes, where when he started his dua, when he started supplicating, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he inflated his tongue. To an extent in the narration it comes, that his tongue was inflated so much that it would be hanging over his chest. It would be hanging over his chest. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he gives his example in the Quran like a dog. إِن تَحْمِلْ عَلَيْهِ يَلْهَثْ أَوْ تَتْرُكْهُ يَلْهَثْ. He would be walking around like that. And then he would turn around to the people. And this was his condition that he became into. So close to Allah, so near Allah. What happened? Just in the split of some minutes and seconds, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought him down so low, where Allah ta'ala, he inflated his tongue to show everyone around them that look, when you jeopardize your iman, when you put your iman into trial and test, Allah ta'ala can take your iman away from you. You won't even realize. And in the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that near the day of Qiyamah, there will be people who would wake up, in the morning as believers, and in the night they would become disbelievers. By night they would become disbelievers. And vice versa, there would be people near the day of Qiyamah that in the night, in the evening, they will be mu'min. They would be believers in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But in the morning, they would no longer have their faith. They would no longer have their iman. Such quickly Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take their iman away from them. Such quickly Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will remove their iman from them. So this is the first thing. Control your iman. Have faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Have yaqeen in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you lose your yaqeen, when you lose your faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you do not have anywhere to turn to. You do not have anywhere to go to. So that is the first thing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says. That the first types of individuals and people that Allah ta'ala does not forgive are people who do not have iman. Then the second thing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says is mushahin. Mushahin, who is mushahin? People who have a lot of adawa, enmity, jealousy, animosity, hatred against other people. Where your heart is not clean. You say salam to your brothers. You say salam to your sisters. You say salam to your friends. But wallahi, in your heart, you have a total different picture for that person. Your heart is not clean. Your heart is not pure. That the minute you get a chance to violate that person, the minute you get a chance to destroy that person's life, wallahi, you would take that chance to destroy that person's life. Your heart is not clean. That is the second thing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says. That yes, you might even get the month of Ramadan. You might even be in the month of Ramadan. But look, your heart is not clean. You have what? Jealousy. You have ghibah filled inside your heart. At the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where some companions, they came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and they said, Ya Nabi Allah, there are two women. There are two women that they are fasting at the moment, Ya Nabi Allah. But they cannot hold on to their fast any longer. They cannot bear their hunger. So Ya Nabi Allah, they want to break their fast. So will you allow them to break their fast? So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he tells the Sahabi, he tells his companion that go ahead and tell those two women to throw up. Go ahead and tell those two women who cannot bear their fast, they do not have anything in their stomach. They do not have anything inside their stomachs. So what are they going to throw up? He doesn't even understand the question. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's telling him that go ahead and tell those two women to throw up. So this companion, he goes and he tells those two women, throw up. They throw up. And subhanAllah, when they throw up, there is pieces of meat that they are throwing up. Now this person, this sahabi, this companion, he's surprised. SubhanAllah, what is this? You said to me that you couldn't bear hunger. But through what I am seeing is you had a really good, mashallah, a big course of meal before. And you were throwing up so much meat. So he comes to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he says, Ya Nabi Allah, what is this? That they were complaining of hunger. And now you told me to tell them to throw up, and they throw up and they're throwing up meat. I don't understand, Ya Nabi Allah. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that, look, physically it seemed that they were fasting. But while they were fasting, they were backbiting. While they were fasting, they were backbiting. Spiritually, they were backbiting. And in the ayah, the Prophet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says what? That when you do backbite, it is as if you eat the dead flesh of your own brother. It is as if you eat the dead flesh of your own brother. So Allah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says that, look, physically they seem that they were fasting. But inside their stomachs, and this was of course a sign that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to show, a miracle of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, look, they were backbiting, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala filled their stomachs. And that is what it is on the day of Qiyamah. That you and I, when you do backbite people, on the day of Qiyamah, we won't be the same way as we are now. We won't be the same way. Your stomach would be inflated with so much meat and flesh. You'll ask Allah, Ya Allah, what is this? This is because you used to backbite individuals and people in the world. You used to backbite people in this world, which is why you have an inflated stomach. So you are fasting in the month of Ramadan, physically, but spiritually, you don't know what your level is. Spiritually, your heart, you don't know if it's clean. Spiritually, your heart, you don't know what you have inside your heart. That's what the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and I'm going to end off with this inshaAllah. At the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was sitting with his companions in a gathering. And a sahabi passes by. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, Huwa fil Jannah. This man, he's guaranteed Jannah. First day. Second day, same scenario, same situation. The guy is passing by, the Prophet ﷺ says he's a Jannati. He's going into Jannah. Second day passes by. Third day comes. The Prophet ﷺ says the same thing when he sees him. Wa fil Jannah. He's going to Jannah. So the Sahaba are surprised, subhanAllah. 3 days. The Prophet ﷺ continuously, he's telling us, he's going into Jannah, he's going into Jannah, he's going into Jannah. What is it that he is doing, due to which the Prophet ﷺ guaranteed him Jannah 3 times. So one sahabi, he accompanies him and goes up to him and he tells him, hey, I want to accompany you, I want to go to your house, I want to stay with you for a little bit. And what was his goal, what was his maqsad? He wanted to see what action he does, due to which the Prophet ﷺ guaranteed him Jannah. So what is he doing? What is he doing in his life, due to which the Prophet ﷺ is guaranteeing him Jannah? I want to see that action so I can bring that into my life as well. I can bring that action into my life as well. What is he doing? So he goes. He sees first day, he's doing the same thing he's doing. He gets up for tahajjud, he's getting up for tahajjud. He's praying salah, he's praying salah. He's reading Quran, he's reading Quran. He's doing the same normal things, same normal routine. So he gets tired. A few days pass by, this individual, this sahabi, this companion, he gets tired. He goes up to him, he says, look, I didn't really need to stay with you. The only reason why I stayed with you was because the Prophet ﷺ said, look, you are going into Jannah. And he said that 3 times to you, 3 days in a row. So I wanted to see what action you were doing, due to which you were guaranteed Jannah. So he says, you stayed with me, man. You've seen whatever I do throughout the day. It's the same thing you do. But there is one thing, that before I go to bed, and wallahi, it is so easy that you and I, each and every single one of us, can do. Today, you and I don't give salam to one another because what? You and I don't speak to one another because what? Oh, he was passing in front of me and he didn't give me salam. So, he doesn't like me. I'm not even going to give him salam. We don't speak to people. We don't speak to our own parents. Days go by, subhanAllah. Kids don't speak to their own parents. You do not speak to your own kids. You do not speak to your own relatives. Your brothers, your sisters. What's the reason? Why? So this companion, he says, before I go to sleep, before I go to bed, I forgive each and every single individual from the bottom of my heart. I forgive everyone from the bottom of my heart. So he says, yes, I think that's the action that I'm looking for. That's the amal I'm looking for. Due to which the Prophet ﷺ guaranteed you Jannah. That look, before you go to bed, you clean your heart. Clean your heart from everyone. From the entire creation, whoever has done you wrong, whoever has did any wrong to you, today is the day to go to them and say, look, I love you for the sake of Allah. I forgive you for the sake of Allah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will utilize and give you the ability to utilize this month of Ramadan in a manner which will benefit you for the rest of your life. So two things again I'm going to summarize. Number one, protect your iman. Have faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Tawakkul in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the second thing, keep your heart pure so that Allah ta'ala, at the end of this month of Ramadan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives each and every single one of us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the